All right, good morning. It is great to see you. You look well this morning. Hope that you are doing good. And we've got a lot of great things going on, and I want to turn your attention to those as we get ready to worship this morning. Of course, Awana is taking off, and we are full steam with Awana. So each night, you know, we have a different theme for Awana. So tonight is Patriotic Night. So we're wearing red, white, and blue tonight at Awana. We'll be here at 5 o'clock, and we just have a great time pouring into our children. If you would like to volunteer and serve in Awana, we can find a spot for you. It's a fantastic ministry, great way to invest in our future generation of believers here at Mount Gilead. We got a lot of kids coming in from our community as well, and it's just great, great time. We will be going to the harbor on Sunday, October the 30th, okay? We do breakfast there and do other ministries. I talked to Pastor Cody over there this week. They have been battling COVID restrictions for a long time, but he said they are back to full swing now, which means as Mount Gilead folks come, we need to bring a full crew, okay, which we probably need 15, 20 folks there. So I want you to call the office and sign up to participate with that. Just let me know that you're coming, and I'll feel better about that. Also, Operation Christmas Child, we've been participating in this ministry for several years. There are boxes in the foyer to right behind you here. So as you leave today, let me encourage you to pick up one of those. You can pack it, put your shipping label on there. There's $9 of shipping that should go in each box. So if you could do that, you just put that check in that box that you bring here and return that box. We will be recollecting those October 31st because we got to get those turned in that next week, okay? Also, we got a church business meeting coming up October 27th. We got a night of worship coming up for the ladies as well. On October 26th from 6 to 8, they will be meeting out in the 5 acres behind the Family Life Center. So, ladies, you want to make sure you bring your own lawn chair for this event, okay? And we'll meet on the grass out there. Young at Heart has a meeting October the 11th. Youth got Fields of Faith coming up. This month, we are taking up our special offering for this month is World Hunger. And we've also been participating with this for many years. But if you want to give to World Hunger, make sure you put that in the memo section of your envelope or on your check. You can also do that online as well. Last thing I want to mention, well, that's a lie. I got two more things. All right. Parent-child dedications November 14th. Okay, if you'd like to participate with that, let Brother Nolan know. And we need to get the cute little baby pictures from you. You can send those to Miss Deborah. All right. Last thing I want to mention is we have an ordination service plan for Brother Danny Downing. It's going to be Sunday, October 17th, okay? And, you know, in the past, if you've been coming here for a while, in the past we've done ordination services in the evenings, okay? But since we have Awana, we've kind of gotten creative and changed some things around a little bit. So I want to draw your attention to this, okay? This will affect all of our adult Sunday school classes, okay? Youth and children classes will continue with their regular schedule, all right? So if you are a youth or children's teacher, you can just tune me out for the next 45 seconds, okay? If you are go to an adult Sunday school class or teach an adult Sunday school class, okay, what we're going to do is from 9 to 9:30 right here in the worship center, instead of Sunday school, all the adult classes will meet in here, and we will have an ordination service for Brother Danny from 9 to 9:30, all right? After that, okay, we're going to meet in the fellowship hall from 9:30 to 10 for a little coffee donut fellowship breakfast, okay? So we'll get real high on sugar, and we'll overeat sugar, and then we're going to come back into the worship center at 10:15 in our sugar comas and have worship, okay? Is everybody clear on that, okay? That will be October 17th, so you need to keep that in mind, okay? I'm going to pray, and then Brother Josh is going to lead us in worship. Thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us today, all right? God, we come before you. We love you. We thank you for today. We need you in our lives, and God, I pray that over the upcoming moments that as we sing, our hearts would be overcome with your grace and mercy. And I pray that as we hear your word this morning, God, that you would teach us and mold us and encourage us comfort us, and at the end of the day, make us to be more like your son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, so good to see you this morning. Let's stand together. And as we do that, I want you to take just a few minutes and find somebody, tell them you love them this morning. Find somebody that might be visiting with us and introduce yourself this morning. Let's take time to greet each other together. Let's sing together this morning as we join into worship. Let's sing.
The church is one foundation. It's Jesus Christ our Lord. She is His new creation. By from every nation, yet one.
Christ has made a way for sinners. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Now, if you hadn't really thought about that, to take a moment and think about what it means that Christ has made a way for sinners. Hey, guess what you are? We're sinners. And yet God would love us so much that by His great love, He would send His Son to make a way for us to know Him and enjoy Him for an eternity. That's why we're here to worship. We're worshiping a great Savior. And part of worship, we give our voices, we give our hearts, we give our spirits to the Lord to reflect the greatness of who He is. And our ushers are coming now as we join in giving a little bit of what the Lord has given to us by way of tithes and our offerings. Our verse this morning that's going to be read is Matthew 5:6. And I've asked Ava Grace, my daughter, if she would come up and read this verse for us as we think about the goodness of God to satisfy our souls. And following that, I'm going to have Brother John come up here, and he's going to pray for our offering as we continue in worship. Ava Grace.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Matthew 5:6.
Pray
together, please. Father, thank you for your blessings. Thank you for this time together. Thank you for providing that way for all of us through Jesus Christ. I pray that you'll be glorified and honored today in this service. Thank you now, Father, for the tithes and offerings that we receive. Bless the gift, bless the giver, God. May it be for your glory and honor. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. If you have your copy of God's Word, I invite you to open to John chapter 6. John chapter 6, I know some of you are going to be used to looking at the scripture on the screen. We had some technical glitches over the last couple of days with this, and so that's not going to be, So open your Bibles. You need to be, you need to own a Bible. You need to bring a Bible to church. Hey, listen, even if you have the Bible on your phone, you still need to bring a Bible to church, a real one, a paper one. Just as a note, I have the Bible on this, but I still preach out of this. Why? Because don't ever trust anything you got to plug in or turn on. That's why, right? Like, I can't get the Bible on the screen. What would I do if I didn't own one of these? Not only that, what would I do if I didn't own some of these? That would be a problem. Nevertheless, we're thankful that you're here. We're thankful to worship together. One of the things that I failed to do when I was up earlier, I was so excited about Ava Grace reading our passage, was to speak to our guests. If you're a guest with us today, thank you so very much for being here. Only thing we really want from you is just to be able to give you some hospitality and to get to know you. We have a little welcome card in the back of your pews there. If you'll take that, fill that out, and before you leave, or as you leave, I'm going to be in one of those doors in the back. Just walk back and hand me this and say, here, glad the sermon was over. I'm so-and-so. Well, I look forward to meeting you. All right. we're in John chapter 6, and we've been working through this text, verses 25 through 35, as we work through John. I told you John 6 is going to take a while to get through, and I did not lie to you. So we're in verses 25 through 35, and we're dealing with the second part of the passage, or the sermon that I started last week, where I called it Good Bread, Good Bread. And so let's stand to honor the reading of God's word. I'm in verses 25 through 35. We're going to read this. I'm going to get on my knees and ask for the Lord's blessings and prayer through his word. And I invite you, if the Lord gives you grace, to join me to do just that. We're in John chapter 6, beginning in verse 25. It says, when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? And Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, what must we do to be doing the works of God? Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. So they said to him, then what signs do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus then said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but my Father gives you true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And they said to him, sir, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Pray with me. Father, we're here coming to you today in worship. We're here believing upon the work of our King, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and finding atonement and forgiveness and restoration and life and satisfaction from the one who is the living water, from the one who is the bread of life. Now I pray that Jesus Christ would be exalted in all of his glory today. That, Father, you would be glorified, that the Spirit would work and move amongst us and get glory as we have our attention and our hearts focused and satisfied in the one who is most meaningful and our greatest treasure. Father, I ask for grace to preach to the glory of your name and for the good of the people that you've sent. Holy Spirit, would you accomplish your work now amongst us? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week we began talking about this miracle that Jesus had done, or particularly talking about the meaning behind the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. Now, what's the point? Why did Jesus do this miracle? What did he want the people then to understand? What does he want us to understand? And I started by calling this sermon Good Bread. And so this is Good Bread Part 2. And if you remember, the illustration I gave at the beginning was just simply, isn't it amazing how often we pick restaurants that we're going to eat at based on the quality of the bread that they serve before the meal? Remember, we talked about that. Well, I want to thank so many of you for, during lunch, to sending me text pictures of all the bread that y'all were eating over lunch. I mean, y'all sent some bread now. I mean, y'all ate, I got pictures of breadsticks and cheesy bread and sweet rolls. Somebody sent me a whole loaf of bread. I just make this observation. You people eat too much bread, and I I do too. I think we have a problem. It's also clear to me that our world would be a much better place if we acted on our love for true bread at least as much as we did at our love for physical bread. Would it be wonderful If our love for Jesus motivated every part of who we are, everything that we did, every word that we said. And that was the point of the miracle of the feeding of 5,000 is that, if you go back and look, we did a whole sermon on this, is that Jesus is a better Moses. And that he doesn't just simply give physical bread, physical needs to take care of us here, but he meets our deepest needs, our most needful desires are satisfied. Our lives are satisfied in Christ. He's the bread of life, satisfies the deepest aspects of life. Now, he is that because he's God. And as God, he has come not only to reveal his glory, but also to make a way for sinners, to restore us to God, to bring us to God, the true bread that brings us eternal life. Now, that brings us to the 2 points that we dealt with last week. And just to catch us up, since it's the same sermon, just a different day. Our first point was, as you know, people struggled with receiving this true bread from heaven, and they're making some mistakes. And the first mistake they made concerning the true bread from heaven is that you've got to work for it, that you must work for food. And of course, Jesus makes it clear that no matter how much we think we have to work and how much we do have to work for so much in the world, we cannot work for salvation. The eternal life, salvation, has already been worked for. It has already been earned. That Christ is the only one who could earn that, and he did that. And now we receive it not by work, but by grace, the grace that comes through the person of Christ Jesus, as we repent and believe. That takes us to the second mistake that we talked about, and that's not recognizing true bread when you see it. I mean, after all that Jesus had done at that point, healing the sick and feeding of the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, this miracle, as I said, that whole miracle was to make them think about the Exodus. I did a whole message on that. You should go back and listen to that. I learned a lot. I don't know if y'all did. I did. Extremely insightful that whole message, they would have seen it connecting Jesus to Moses and connecting that moment of Jesus providing bread to Moses, God through Moses providing manna. And so Jesus is showing himself as a better Moses, the prophet who Moses said was coming, who would be like him, that he was that prophet. He had done the healing of the sick. He had fed the 5,000. He had done all of these signs. And what did they do? They still asked for another sign. And what we talked about was the fact that Jesus essentially is saying, you don't need another sign. You don't need more proof. You just need to believe based on what you've already seen in Christ. Because that's the work. He says, you want to do work? This is the work that you should be doing. You should believe. You should believe. Now, that brings us today to the third mistake. And it's the only point that we're going to talk about this morning. Additional point. And that is this. That God only works in the past. That's a mistake that they were making as they were thinking about what it means to receive true bread, which is eternal life. That God only works in the past. And look, this is a huge temptation as we read the Bible and think. You know, we think to ourselves, man, wouldn't it be awesome to have lived in the past? To lived in Bible days, where because we tend to think that God just works in powerful ways in the Scripture, in the past. You know, I see all the miracles, to see the changing of water to wine, to see him raising the dead and healing the sick. Wouldn't it be awesome to see God work if we could just go back to those biblical days? What's interesting is that's the very same thing that the people thought that he was talking to that day. Actually, in the Scripture, the people who lived in Jesus' day wanted the same thing, that they thought the same thing, that God, yeah, he works in the past. It wouldn't have been great to go back to the Exodus and see God work. I mean, wouldn't it be great to see God providing the manna every single day on the ground, and to see Moses come down out of the mountain with the Ten Commandments, and to see God lead the people with a cloud by day and a fire by night. Those Jews look back at the past and glory, those days of glory, and thought to themselves, wow, would it be awesome to be able to go back to the scriptural days and to see God work. And Jesus steps in at this moment. He says this. Hey guys, You don't have to go back to the past because God's not done working. As a matter of fact, essentially what he's saying is that all the things that God did back then for your forefathers through Moses is to help you understand what God is doing today. The people had quoted how God had worked through Moses for their forefathers and the Exodus, the deliverance from Egypt, and then his providence in the 40 years of wilderness journey. They quoted this in verse 31. Look at what they said. He said, "Our fathers ate manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." And then Jesus takes that. He says, okay, see what they're doing. They're referring to the past. This is what God's done in the past. Yes, look how God has worked for our forefathers. And then Jesus takes this passage and he reframes it for their day. And when you look at the way Jesus repackages it and reframes it, it sounds like that he's correcting them. And he is correcting them, but he's not correcting them in the way that you think he's correcting them. Look at verse 32. Jesus then said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but my Father gives you true bread from heaven." Now, it sounds like he's correcting them, and the way it sounds like he's correcting them is by saying, now, you think Moses gave you bread from heaven? You think Moses provided you manna? Moses didn't provide you manna. God is the one who provided you manna. But that's not what he's saying. That's not the way he's correcting them. We know that because we know the people knew that it wasn't Moses that was out putting bread on the ground every day for them. They knew it was God who had provided the manna. But here's what they also knew, that it had been a long time since he had done that. That yes, God did that, but God did that through Moses, if you were there at that day, 1,300 years before. And so in their mind, well, God does work. And God works for our fathers and our forefathers. Look at all these things that God's done in the past. God didn't really work today. And that is what Jesus is correcting. What he says in verse 32, look again how he says this. He says, "But you said this," God through Moses gave bread from heaven, "but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven." So he's correcting them. Why are you quoting me what God did in the past and yet completely ignore what God's doing in your presence right now? And so they're making some mistakes that he's correcting. And here are some, here are the mistakes that they're making and how he corrects them through this passage. The first mistake that they make and how he corrects is this. It is who stands before them. He corrects them by first declaring clearly who he is, who's standing before them. You know, I think it's interesting when you look at the way Jesus refers to God in this passage. Did you notice that? You notice how Jesus refers to God? Jesus doesn't refer to God as God in this passage. Anybody catch the way he refers to God? It's my Father. He didn't say, well, God says this and God does that. No. He refers to God as my Father. It's something that he's done several times, and we'll see in just a moment. But here's what's interesting. He's not the first person in this whole conversation to refer to their fathers. Now, the crowd had referred to their fathers. I mean, remember they said, the crowd says, our fathers ate manna in the wilderness. And this is not the first conversation that Jesus had in John where somebody referred to their fathers. Like, for instance, another passage that's very closely aligned with this passage, another miracle very closely aligned with this miracle, is the miracle of the eternal life, the living water at the well, the woman of the well in John 4. So we're going to see a parallel there in just a second. But for now, in that conversation, Jesus meets this woman at the well, and in that back and forth, she says this, our fathers worshipped on this mountain. You see that? So the crowd said, our fathers ate manna from heaven. our man in the wilderness. And the woman at the well said, well, our fathers worshipped on this mountain. What were they doing? They were clarifying their identity. The Jews had forefathers who were the Jews who God had led out of Egypt in the Exodus. They knew who their forefathers were. They knew who their identity was. They were Jews, God's chosen people. And then the Samaritan. Well, she knew who she was too, and she wasn't a Jew because her father was different. She was a half-breed between Jew and Gentile, and they weren't allowed to worship in the same way. But they knew who they were. And so Jesus says, when he identifies his father, here's essentially what he's saying. He's saying, I'm different than you, than all of you, because of who my father is. Remember how he had spoken to them in the past using that term, my father, for God. Several times up to this point in John. Remember in the cleansing of the temple where Jesus drove out the money changers to the animal sellers. He said in John 2:16, and he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade. And then not long after that, after healing the lame man at the pool of Bethesda, he gets in trouble by the Jews for healing on the Sabbath. And here's what he says to them in John 5:17. But Jesus answered to them, my father is working until now, and I am working. God's working, God's my father, and God is working, and I am working. And they didn't like that very much. They didn't like that line of discussion. And that discussion ends like this in John 5:43. He says, I have come in my father's name, and you do not receive me. So yeah, Jesus had the same forefathers as they did. Yes, Jesus was a Jew. But who was standing in their midst? Not just a Jew, not just the son of Joseph, but the Son of God. Because his father was different. And it would do us well to remember as we come to worship whose presence we're in. Not just a Jew, not just a man, not just a story written in an ancient book. But we have come to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Son of God. So we need to remember, we need to know who stands in our midst before us. Not make that mistake. Secondly, the second aspect that Jesus needs to correct in their thinking is when it is that God works. Now this won't be hard to point out. This will be very quick. Notice the tense change in verse 32. He changes the word gave that they used to the word gives. Look at verse 32. It says, Jesus then said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. Now, that's pretty easy. That's God doesn't just work past tense. That God works present tense. That God just didn't gave back then. I don't think that exactly works. Sorry, Robbie Ann. Yes, God gave back then. But God still gives now. God gives today. God works mightily in our midst. And that's what he's saying. He's saying, look, God not only worked back then through Moses, but God is working today through a better Moses, through a better Savior, through his very own Son. And then there's a third aspect that he has to correct. And we'll spend the rest of our time talking here. And that is this, that the superiority of what Jesus provides over Moses. That what Jesus provides is so much superior to what Moses provided. Under Moses' leadership, obviously, God gave what? God gave bread from heaven. But through Jesus, again, notice what God gives.
Verse 32, let's read it again. And Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven." True bread from heaven. Like there's bread, but then there's true bread. It's like, it kind of reminds me of the way technology works today and how fast it moves, and we always want kind of the best thing that we have. I don't have my phone with me, but everybody's got a phone, right? And you got your phone, and you think your phone's you got the newest, the best, the very, you know, just you went and bought, like last week, you went and bought an iPhone 12 for like, I don't know, $2,000. You're like, I got the best phone there is in the universe. And then somebody said, "No, I just got this, iPhone 13. Huh? There's an iPhone 13. I didn't know there was an iPhone 13. And then you don't care that much about the iPhone 12. You want the iPhone 13, right? And so Jesus is kind of doing that. He said, like, y'all are really interested in bread and something that can feed your body and take care of your physical needs. But you kind of know there's something way better than just bread. That you have needs that are deeper, that can't be filled with just bread. And I am bringing something so much superior. True bread. Which really does beg the difference. What's the difference? Beg the question, what's the difference between bread and true bread? Well, you know the difference. We've talked about this in the past. Well, bread fills the stomach for a few hours. True bread fills the soul forever. That we all have physical needs, and thankfully the Lord watches over us and He provides for those needs day after day after day. But those needs have to be met over and over and over again. You ate breakfast, you eat lunch, you'll eat supper. Some of you will find excuses to eat all through the day. And anybody ever just go to the refrigerator and just open it up and not even be hungry? I just thought that's what we do, we eat. Jesus is the bread who fills the soul, who answers the deepest questions of life, that fills the deepest meaning of life, that makes life make sense, the reason that we live for. And when we come to Christ, we never have to go to anything else because He's the only one that can meet it. It's true bread. So He's using this idea of bread as a metaphor here. It's the same way that He used the metaphor of water with the woman at the well. You remember this conversation in John chapter 4? You can turn and look. I know it's not on the screen. So in John chapter 4, I don't know, should hear pages turning, or at the very least the sound of fingers swiping. I don't know, but just follow along. And hold your place in John 6, because this is interesting to me. In John 4, 13 through 15, this conversation that He had with the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give him will never be thirsty. The water that I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Sounds a lot like what He said about true bread, isn't it? The woman said to Him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Well, that sounds good. I thought I was just coming to get water, but now you're offering living water. Give me that water that will sustain me forever. I won't have to come back here. See, she didn't quite understand yet that He was talking about water for the soul. And then compare that to the conversation that He's just had in John 6. And we'll walk through some of the verses here. Verse 32, "And Jesus said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you,'" you've heard this verse many times today, hold on to it, "'it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you,'" now, "'true bread from heaven.'" Verse 34, "They said to Him, 'Sir, give us this bread always.'" Like, yes, that would be great. Bread that a place that we can go that we can be fed forever, that we will always have our physical needs met. And they were like, He was like, "No, that's, you're not getting it. It's more than that. It's a deeper need." But then listen to where that deeper need is met. John 4, 26. What was the answer to her about what spiritual, what eternal, what living water is. John 4:26. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. That I am the Christ. That I am the living water. That meets your deepest longings of your soul. Notice how he answered the crowd with the bread. What is this true bread? For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. In verse 35, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. See, God gave bread to the Hebrews to feed their stomach for the moment. But God gives bread in Christ to feed our souls forever. And so I think it's important for us to look inwardly and ask ourselves, are we in need of correcting? Have we forgotten who God really is in Christ? That who is our Savior, who is our King, who is our Lord, is not just the story, is not just a man, but He is the all-powerful, all-knowing, all-wise, sufficient Son of God. And have we forgotten whose presence dwells with us this morning? Have we forgotten that Jesus is not just the Savior of people in the past, but that God not only works through Bible times, but God also works today? That what God has promised to do through Christ is greater than what He ever did for the Jews through Moses? And have we forgotten that God has given us today the Holy Spirit to lead us, to guide us, to shape us, to give us wisdom, to do a saving work in our hearts? John 14:16, He says, listen to this, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another helper to be with you forever. I love that. Jesus says, I'm going to ask the Father, when I leave, He'll give another helper, and that helper will be with you forever. Because we have this tendency to think that God just works in the past, right? But last time I checked, that is today falls into the category of forever. And so the helper is here. God is here amongst us. He will not leave us. Have you forgotten that Jesus told His disciples before He ascended into heaven, and behold, I am with you, thank you, always, to the very end of the age. God is amongst us now in the person of Christ. God is amongst us now in the person of the Holy Spirit. And have we forgotten how much more superior Jesus is than Moses or anything else in this world? It brings us to verse 35. Jesus said to them, I'm the bread of life. Remember the two stories we just talked about? The story of Jesus meeting the woman at the well and providing living water. Jesus feeding the crowd and saying He is there to provide true bread. And now He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Yes, God provided the bread through Moses to feed the stomach, but Jesus is the bread of God which sustains the soul. He is the living water that satisfies us forever. And so what you need to do when you look at verse 35 is you need to realize that verse 35 is a picture of what biblical salvation really is. So we have a tendency to think about salvation like this, is that, yes, I'm a sinner and my sin separates me from God. And because of sin, I'm dead in my sin and I can't get myself to God. And therefore, God, through the work of Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit, does the work of the cross and regeneration and then brings me to God so that I won't go to hell when I die. Because I don't want to go to hell when I die, even though I deserve judgment for my sin and I am a great sinner. Jesus is a great Savior. And therefore, when I die, I want to go to heaven. And is that a right picture of salvation? Yes, it is. But is that a complete picture of salvation. No, it's not. Because the salvation that Jesus offers is not simply a salvation that starts when you take your last breath here. It's a salvation that starts the moment that you trust Christ Jesus as your Savior and Lord. You see, salvation is not just a picture of having your sins forgiven and not being judged for them. But salvation is finding your complete satisfaction and joy in this world and the next, not from anything else save Jesus Christ. That he who comes to me doesn't hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. Find your complete satisfaction in Christ alone. Living a satisfied life, joyful in Christ, that's salvation. I hadn't quoted Spurgeon in a while. Thought it was time. Charles Spurgeon said this out of one of his sermons. He says, "You say, if I had a little more, I should be very satisfied. You make a mistake. If you are not content with what you have, you would not be satisfied if it were doubled." What's Spurgeon saying? What he's saying is this. He's saying you were made for Christ. And it's only in Christ are you going to find true fulfillment in life and in eternity. And if you're not satisfied in Christ, then you'll never be satisfied in anything else, no matter how much of it you have. And so let's not make the same mistakes that the crowd was making in that moment. Who stands before us? The Almighty. When does he work? Always. And what is he superior than? All things. Hallelujah. What a Savior. Join me in prayer. Gracious Father, we do pray, rejoicing in Christ, and Christ alone for our salvation. And our salvation and forgiveness of sin, not simply to escape judgment, but to enjoy you right now, right here. For life to make sense, not to simply have our physical needs met as much as they are or much as we may want in this life, but to want right things, the things of God. And not just the things of God in terms of fruits of the Spirit like love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, those types of things. But to desire the one from which all those flow. To desire you. And to long for you. But then also to drink upon you living water every day. To consume the true bread of eternal life every day. And Lord, we need wisdom because this life is hard. This life leaves us wanting. This life leaves us with questions and needs to be met. And Lord, it seems like no matter where we run, no matter what we turn to, we can't find those answers. But Lord, remind us that we don't need answers. We need God. We need a Father. We have a Father if Christ is our Savior. What a wonderful thought that we might become, even sinners, might become children, sons and daughters of the Almighty. And so, Father, I pray right now for our church. I pray for those in our hearing, maybe, Lord, first for believers here who are going through a lot in this world. This world's hard. It's hard for believers. It's hard for the church. Jesus said, if they persecuted me, how much more will they persecute you? He said, in this world, you'll have trouble. Then he said, take heart, I've overcome it. I've overcome the world. And so, Father, we find ourselves at the well, needing to drink deeply. satisfy our souls. Give us wisdom. Give us peace as we lean upon you. Father, for those who are lost here, maybe in our worship center this morning, maybe in the airways, listening in the future, or even now. And you've been looking so long for something to make life make sense. Where is it found? Nowhere else save the Savior, the Son of God. Would you go to that well? Would you sit at his table? Would you be willing to say, I need more than I can provide for myself. I need more than the world can provide. I'm just left empty. I need you. The Bible says that if you'll admit that to the Lord, that you'll repent of your sin, that you'll turn from it and say, Jesus, I believe that you lived a perfect life for me, that you went and you died on the cross for sinners, and that you rose again, overcoming sin, hell, death, and the grave, and I am trusting upon Christ alone for my salvation. A salvation that just doesn't take care of your eternal life, but a salvation that takes care of eternal life starting today. In a moment, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. This will be a good time to sing, to rejoice, a good time to pray. We're going to be here. I'll be here. I'll be happy to pray for you. We'll make these steps a place to do business with God if you want to come and just do business with God here or maybe right where you are. Gracious Heavenly Father, we meet you now at the table, at the well. Would you satisfy our souls with nothing else but Christ? We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Just stand together.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the bonds of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior,
God's people said, amen. Thank you so very, very much for being here. Thank you for worshiping with us today. I've met several guests, and I look forward to getting to know you all the more. And so make sure you, if I hadn't met you, even if I have, to shake my hand on the way out. All right, we've got some awesome things coming up. We've got Awana tonight, and it's going to be a very blessed time. So if you're involved in that, come and be a part of that precious time. And again, we'll remind you about Sunday the 17th as we have an elder ordination time in a very special way. That's going to be a wonderful time. All right. Brother Steve Butler is going to come. He's going to close us out with prayer. Where's Brother Steve? He's around here. Here he is. Okay. As he comes, Brother Josh, is there anything else that we need to mention from a music ministry side? All right. Very good. And Brother Steve, you close us out with prayer, and then I will just remind you that as we leave, are we dismissed? No, my Dear Jesus, we can do better than that. Are we just dismissed? What are we? What does that mean for you? What does it mean for you to be sent? It means you have the gospel. And you have neighbors who are lost. You have coworkers who are lost. You have friends and people that need to know true bread and living water. We have the gospel. Let's go change the world.
Father, we thank you for the message you've given us. We thank you for the word that we have. We thank you for giving us the opportunity this week to share it with somebody. Father, we pray that as we leave today that we'll have that in our mind, and Father, that you'll place it in our hearts to share the gospel with somebody this week. Thank you for the health you've given us. We pray for those who are not able to be here today for reasons other than health, and then they can't make it for whatever reason. We lift them up to you this morning for sicknesses and whatever. I pray that you'll be with them today. Help us through this week, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.